I make large paintings that come off the wall and float in the breeze or maybe move with the air as people pass by. And I think about how landscapes might shift over time and food and how the earth nourishes us. And a lot of my work is made on compostable materials with colours that I make from kitchen waste. And when I begin a project, I often have a place in mind and I like to look at that place from above. So I use an app called Google Earth, which is free and anyone can use it. So I've called this workshop Armchair Traveller. And I thought we could look at some of these satellite images and find some interesting shapes that would make a good starting point for paintings. So we are starting the video now. This is my studio in Haggerston in London. And I think we're going to whiz around the world in about 2 minutes. So here is some bulb fields in the Netherlands with some lovely colors. And we're going to, where will we go next? I think we're going to go to Spain, that's it. So this is the Alhambra Palace in Spain, a very hot place and a beautiful garden called the Paradise Garden, which is cool and shady. And here we are in Saudi Arabia, in some farm, a farm. And you can see the irrigation arms have made these circles in the landscape and amazing an orange colour of the earth. And then, oh yes, now we're going to Australia and some salt fields. And this looks like an abstract painting already. I really think this is an interesting image. Where are we going next? I think we might be going to California next. Oh no, we're not. We're going to Antarctica. And this is the edge of the ice. You see some of these shapes that the ice makes as it breaks up. And then I think now we're probably going to be in California looking at some very straight edges to some fields in Salinas, California. Some interesting colors in that one. And then I think we're going back to the UK to look at this amazing horse, which I think is Anglo-Saxon. So it's about 1200 years old and it's cut into the chalk in Oxfordshire. And then finally, I think we're going to go back to Somerset and look at some farmland there with some irregular shaped fields. And I think that's it. That should be the end of the video. So here we are back in the studio. So I thought I'd just go over the materials that we have first. If you can look down at my my table. So I've stuck a piece of A4 paper to the table. You don't have to stick it down, but I just happen to have some tape. We've got some paint brushes and a pencil. We've got some tissue paper, some felt tip pens, some glue. Doesn't have to be that type of glue. There's some acrylic paint. I'm actually going to use watercolor today, but acrylic paint is fine as well. Some water to dampen my brush. And I've got a little, one of these little palettes, but a plate or a saucer will do fine as well. I've got a few little bits of paper just in case I want to dry my brush out as I paint. So in your packs, I thought I would actually make a quick drawing today, but I think in your resource packs, you should have some images that I took off Google Earth. So there's the one of Somerset farmland, which I think I'm going to start with today. And then here are some of the other ones. This one of the horse is a slightly different horse than I showed in the video. This one is in a place called Westbury in Somerset. And it's not as old, but I thought it would be easier to paint. So choose an image or maybe find one that you prefer. And as I say, I'm going to start with a very quick drawing. It should just take me a few minutes. But if you don't want to draw, there are some templates in your pack, and you could just paint onto one of those. And I think if you decide to do that, then maybe you might like to add some extra lines or think about what kind of colours you want to use. Because I think the nice thing about this project is really you could use whatever colours you like. And I don't know if you saw at the beginning, I like these little ponds here in this image. There are some pictures behind me, and some of them I've done in really quite muted colours, which are probably in watercolour. And then other ones are much brighter with more opaque colours, and I will have used some acrylic paint for those probably. So here we go. As you can see, I'm really just trying to make some interesting shapes. I'm not worried about this being exactly the same as the photograph. In fact, I think it can be quite nice if you go, if you become quite free. Now, I chose this particular image because I really like the shape of these fields here. I think they're so strange. And they might have been this shape for hundreds of years. But they look quite surreal. There we are. Now my drawing doesn't look anything like the photograph really. I think that is absolutely fine. All we're trying to do is to look at some marks and look at some shapes and see if we can come up with a painting. There we are. And you could think about what kind of colours you want to use. You might use really bright colours. You might want to think about a kind of mystical quality. So you could use oranges and purples, or you might just want to use quite traditional landscape colours, greens and browns, but it is entirely up to you. Yeah. So I think that's a good enough place to start. Now, one of the things that I thought people might like to do is to use some tissue paper, almost as a kind of ready-made colour. So I've got some here. I've got pinks and reds. Really, this is just what I had at home. Some of this comes off old presents. And I'm just going to get my glue stick. And I'm going to put this over some of the field shapes. This is a really huge stick of glue, which is quite exciting in itself. So, and I'm just going to make some slight wrinkles in it, because one of the things I do sometimes, instead of looking at images of landscape, I might look at the patterns in skin. And I sometimes think about our own skin and this thin layer of soil that goes around the earth. And I think about how we should be caring for that as we care for our own skin. So there we are. You could cut this with scissors if you have them, or you could just tear it. So you can see I'm just going to wrinkle it a little bit. And it doesn't matter if you don't. I might just find a little bit of extra just to fill that little gap in at the top. I think it's quite nice if you can use some sort of overlapping bits, which will make some patterns. And in a minute, I'm going to switch to using some paints. But you don't have to. You could go on with the tissue paper if you wanted to. I think it's quite nice if the tissue paper just overlaps as well. There we are. I'm going to fold that bit in there and that bit in there. I might put a little bit more of this green on. I wonder if anybody's using more vibrant colours than this. Maybe you're using some reds or purples, pinks. Actually, if I look at the picture that I've just been, that I took these shapes from, some of the fields almost look pink. So it might be quite nice to use that colour if you wanted to. There we are. So if anybody wanted to comment and tell me if they are just going to use tissue paper, I'd be quite interested. So I've got some water here. I'm going to use these watercolours. And you can see my box is quite messy. I use watercolours quite a lot at the beginning of a project. I'm going to start with quite a vibrant colour. I love this. This is called lemon yellow, and it's just a lovely cool yellow. I thought I might put some of these really bright colours up here in these fields. If you look at these fields, they've got some shapes. I think where they've cut the wheat or the corn. So it might be nice to try and get some of those textures in. I'm just going to do some very quick kind of watery bits. And some of the colours I'm going to leave really quite pale. Look at me going over the lines. I think it's really nice if you can just sort of flood areas and let the colours flow into each other. So I'm going to leave some places quite pale. Almost as if we're letting a bit of air into the painting. There we are. Now this is one of my favourite colours. This is called sap green. But if you don't have sap green, it really doesn't matter. You could take a bit of yellow and just put a tiny bit of blue in it. And then you should get a nice, vibrant, light green. Yeah. I like this big field shape. Use quite a lot of water here. It's one of the things I love about watercolours is their wateriness. You get some lovely kind of flooded shapes. And as they dry, you see what kind of marks you get. And if I want a colour to be a little bit more vibrant, I can just float a bit more in at the edges. And then as they dry, we'll see what kind of shapes we get, what kind of marks.
So for everyone joining us today, we'd absolutely love to hear where you're joining us from. If you've got a question for Liz, you can pop that in the Q&A box below. We'd love to hear from you.
So, I think the next colour I'm going to use is quite a vibrant orange. I do have an orange here. I think I might just mix my own up. So I'll start off with quite a lot of yellow. I like this colour here. It's kind of a crimson colour. I'm just going to start to mix some of that in. We want quite a lot, actually. you can see which colours I use the most. This yellow has almost run out in this little paint box that I've got. There we go, I think that's like a good start. I'll just quickly block in some of these shapes. And when I sort of blocked in quite a lot of this, I'll probably go back and make some of these shapes a little bit more intense. Some of these colours. So I'm wondering if anybody is using sort of blues and pinks and purples. I think that would be quite interesting.
We've got some really wonderful people joining us today, Liz. Just to let you know, we've got a group joining from Leeds, which is fantastic. We've got Farnham Hospital. Big hello to everyone there. Thank you so much. They said they're really enjoying it and thanks for this. It's great. And there's another user connecting from Guildford. So thank you so much to everyone joining us today. Amy says that they're using a mixture of paints and tissue paper. Can't wait to see everyone's work. As always, we'd absolutely love to see your artworks uploaded to our gallery, and you can do that at the end of the session.
Right. I said at the beginning that when I make some of my work, I use colours that I make myself out of waste from my own kitchen. I'm thinking about wasted food, really. But I use things like the skins of onions or the stones from avocados, which make a lovely pink colour. And I use tea bags and coffee grounds for sort of oranges and browns. So when I start to sketch at the beginning of a project, I might use kind of oranges and yellows quite a lot. Just because I know that when I make the final work, I'm going to have quite a lot of those colours in it. But I also use red cabbage, which I use the outer leaves that we're not going to eat. And they give a really amazing sort of purpley blue colour. Or if you put a little bit of vinegar into the dye, then they come out quite pink. But the trouble is with those colours is they don't last very long. Also might use beetroot sometimes to make a really lovely pink, but again, it does tend to fade. Whereas the colours, the yellows and browns, have got a lot of something called tannin in them. And so they really last quite a long time. So this is a colour I like. This is called ultramarine. I think so far we've just used four colours out of our paint box. We've used five, that's it. No, four. So I thought I'd make up a nice dark green colour. Quite bluey, and just float that into this area down here.
So Liz, you use quite a lot of watercolours and that kind of really soft palette within your work. Is there a reason why you love using watercolour paints? Is there kind of a specific property that those paints offer? Can you talk to us a bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, it's the wateriness. They're quite transparent as well, a lot of the colours that I use. I mean, you can get opaque ones, but I use quite a lot of transparent colours. And when I make my big work, the material that I use, if you hold it up against the light, it does become quite translucent. So I really like those properties. I think about landscapes that shift. And I think with translucency and these kind of watery marks, you get a feeling that things aren't permanent, which is something that I really want in my work. The idea that everything kind of shifts around and changes. And I think one of the things that is interesting in these images from Google Earth is that when we think about traditional landscape painting, we might think about horizon. Traditionally, you would have a horizon in place. But now, and maybe that's something that grounds us. Maybe that is something that sort of anchors us. And when we walk around looking at our phones, looking at a map, we're seeing the landscape in quite a different way. We're seeing it without a horizon. And I wonder what that means, really, if that's something that is quite freeing. I like this app because it almost feels as if you're floating above the earth and sort of looking down on it like a bird, and you could go anywhere, even though you're actually sitting in your chair at home. In fact, I deliberately chose the chair I'm sitting on today because it's got arms. I thought that went well with the armchair traveller idea. So there we are. I've just really put some of these colours in very, very washily, because I feel it's almost as if you've got light coming up from the ground, where you can see the sort of bits I haven't filled in.
Just to give everyone a kind of indication of time, we're about halfway through the workshop today. I'd like to extend a big hello to everyone joining us from Joshua Ward at Homerton. They love creating new landscapes. Thank you so much for joining us today. We've also got everyone on the Jim Burley unit joining us, and they join us every single week. And it's really fantastic to have people coming back. We're thrilled that you're enjoying the workshops.
So I'm just going to use a little bit of a kind of pinky purpley colour, just to sort of offset some of the other colours. So I can imagine that if I had some red cabbage or some beetroot, those would be the kind of colours that I would get from those vegetables. I like to make a lot of these paintings. You know, I think it's quite nice if they're made really quickly and then don't just stick with one, make several. Just flood in some of that down here just to balance out that bit there. Use some of that just to, I'm assuming this is a road actually, and some sort of path. I thought it might be nice if we just use a bit of that purpley colour to flood that in. And I think that this funny kind of butterfly shape is probably a lake, but I don't know. I don't think it's a car park.
Liz, we've had some really sorry about that. Just to interject, we've had some really wonderful questions through. We have a question from Barbara who asks, what guides your decisions to put one colour here and another there?
Well, you know what? I think it is quite random. I wanted this painting to... I wanted to think about kind of nourishment and farmland, and I thought so really kind of vibrant yellows and oranges might be appropriate. I suppose I could have made it just a really lush green. And I think partway through making a painting, I start to just let go and let the painting kind of take over. And so, I felt that we just needed something to offset those kind of those oranges. If you're interested, I was thinking about some landscape painters and some and colours, and how they use colour. And one of the painters I was thinking about is an artist called Paul Clay. And he was really interested in sort of mystical aspects of colour. So he's a really interesting person to look at. And there's an American artist who was working in the 20th century called Richard Diebenkorn. He made beautiful abstract paintings, some of which were inspired by some trips he took in a small aircraft over California. So I think he's a really lovely person to look at as well. And I'm sure you will have heard of David Hockney, who's a British artist who's been making lots and lots of work recently. And he starts by making drawings on his iPad. And then he makes them into huge paintings. And one of the things he said recently, when we're in lockdown, was you can't cancel spring. And I just thought, what a lovely thing to say. So maybe you want to go and have a look at some of his paintings. I think he's going to be showing quite soon in a big show.
I'd like to take this moment to say a big hello to Sarah, who also submitted a wonderful question about colour, which, Liz, I think you've answered wonderfully. Sarah's joining us all the way from Bahrain. So thank you so much for joining in the workshop.
So when I'm working, I do try and sort of balance the colours a bit. So this dark going with this dark, and these, your eyes sort of moving up into these yellows. There's a sort of tree there. I'm just going to put that in like that. And I thought I'd just put a little bit of paint over where I put the tissue paper here and see if we can get any more marks to come out. Which you don't have to do that if you don't want to. Now, I think I'm going to just intensify some of these colours, particularly the orange. I think it's quite nice if it sort of glows. I'm going to make it quite a ready orange. Yeah, I'll just flood a bit of that into that wonderful field shape there. I can't wait to see what people produce.
And that's a really wonderful reminder that everyone can upload their work to our gallery, and you can do that at hospital-rooms.com. We have a page for Digital Art School with a dedicated tab that says gallery, so you can do that there.
I like to put some sort of washy colours in. I'm working on quite a small painting today, because we don't have very long. I was thinking it might be nice to produce a really large one of these and take quite a long time. Or maybe people could work in groups and produce a big sort of communal one. So there were some roofs in the picture, and they weren't red. I think they were grey. I just want some little dots of colour. So I thought I'd think about these as being almost like little red roofs. And if you get a piece of towel or something, or rag, you can just blot them. that makes quite a nice shape as well. I think there's something exciting going on here. My orange has flowed right into the green, which I really like. Let's just use a bit more yellow here and try and make this a bit more vibrant. And if you're using acrylic paint, I think you could get some lovely textures because it's going to be a bit thicker and a bit more opaque. So there are some paintings on the wall behind me, which I made with acrylic paint. And those colours are a bit more opaque. There we go. So I think I might just, trouble is I can always see something else I can do. So I think I'm probably going to stop with the paint for the moment. And I just thought I'd add a little bit of texture using a felt tip pen. I've got a blue one, but really you could use any colour. I'm just going to make some kind of scribbly shapes. No kind of accuracy or trying to draw a tree or anything like that. Just trying to put a different mark into the work. Maybe put some more up there as well. Where the paint is very wet, my felt tip isn't really working. And there are some little trees in this bit of the image. So I'm just going to put some little dots in. And it's really just to put some slightly different marks into. There we go. And I think I'll just use a little bit of paint over those marks just to tone them down a bit. If you're using acrylic, you might want to make your acrylic really thin to do this, or maybe not color over the marks because the paint will be more opaque and you might not see anything at all. So there are some places in here where I'm quite liking the colors. So I like the blue with the orange, and I like this, these greens and oranges here. So I think I'm just going to put a little bit more of that green, maybe draw around those fields a bit. It's funny how one color kind of makes another color zing. I think you might have talked about that in some of the other sessions that you've done.
So to give everyone a time check, we've got about 10 minutes of the workshop left. If you haven't finished your artwork and you are able to do so, please feel free to carry on this afternoon. We'd absolutely love to see them.
So I think that I might just put this piece aside for the moment and give it a little bit of time to dry out. I've got this image, which is from those salt pans in Australia. And I really like this image. I think it would be a really, really quick one to do. So very, very quickly, I'm going to get a kind of greeny colour. I'm going to add quite a lot of white to that because that image to me looked really kind of hot and washed out, where all the water had evaporated to leave the paint at the to leave the salt. So of course you don't have to do another one. You could just carry on with your other painting, or you could put it to one side and do this with me as you like. And I'm not even going to fill in all of these areas with colour. I'm just going to kind of flood. And this is really where the watercolour comes in, because if you think about the salt pans, that is about the seawater evaporating. And this this paint almost works in the same way. So the water is going to evaporate and we should just get some really nice kind of painterly marks. There we go. Now, I may have been a bit ambitious and I probably won't get this finished, but it really doesn't matter. What I wanted to do with this one is take some of this vibrant orange and just put some of these lines in, because I do think that that greeny, the greens and the blues go really nicely with these orangey colours. There we go. I wasn't sure if I'd lost you there, Jen, because you didn't move your head for a while.
I don't, yeah. I think it's lovely that we can see each other. Obviously, no one else can see us at the top.
Sorry.
But I'm still here.
I was a little bit worried that my internet might have gone down and I'd lost you.
This is just a good, really good moment to let everyone know we've got about 5 minutes left.
Okay.
And it's great that Liz is kind of whizzing through this one and giving us a really lovely option of what it would look like if you kind of did work very intuitively and very quickly.
So what I wanted to do, obviously I could do much more on this. I think I'll put this one aside and get the first one back, because I just wanted to say that the good thing about this viewpoint is, of course, there's no right way up. So you could take this painting and say, well, do I prefer it that way or that way or that way? And I actually don't know the answer to that yet. I might need to live with it for a bit. But one of the things I thought might be fun is I've got this ready cut mount, but I think in your packs, you've got some cardboard, some A3 cardboard, or you could do this with paper. So you could either cut yourself a mount or you could tear one to go around your painting and just pop that on. And obviously once you're happy with where it is, you could stick it down on the back with some tape or with some glue. And in your packs, I just put these little pictures of armchairs, and they're just my armchairs from home. And I thought we could put some onto the mount, or maybe you would like to use, say, some little images that you could tear out of birds, or you could draw some just to remind us that this is the armchair traveller. And should I try and hold that up or? Okay, so I'm just going to use a bit of glue to stick these onto the mount. There we go. I'll try and put a little bit of tape on the back. But really, you can see this is a bit rough. And there we are. So, can you see that? That's sort of where I've finished. That's a good idea, isn't it? I could go back. So wow, thank you very much for joining me. I can't wait to see what people have done.
Thank you so much, Liz. That was an absolutely fantastic workshop. Thank you so much again to everyone that's joined us today. It's been really incredible to kind of whiz around the world with Liz, and we hope you all get to continue the great work this afternoon, if that's possible. If you're still here with us, I'd like to share the story of hospital rooms and how the workshop today has come about. We are a London-based arts mental health charity, and we transform inpatient mental health units with extraordinary contemporary art. I've no doubt that there are units that we've worked with previously that have joined us for the workshop today. We began the digital art school in response to COVID-19 lockdowns when our in-person work in units was put on hold. It's been hugely important for us to build a wonderful creative community, and we can all join together and feel part of something really special. We're also now an award-nominated programme. You can find the library of our past workshops and all of the previous digital art school workshops on our YouTube channel, where you'll also find a variety of original classes from world-class artists with collage, sculpture, right through to painting and even storytelling. Please do have a look and subscribe to our channel. We're always uploading new videos. We also have a digital art school newsletter, which keeps you informed of upcoming workshops, the materials you need, along with any relevant downloads and links to last week's video. You can sign up for that at hospital-rooms.com. We'd absolutely love for you to share your artworks with us from any of our digital art school workshops by uploading to our online gallery. We love seeing the works you've created, and we do share your work with our artists. You can do so anonymously, or you can let us know your name and where you are. If you have finished painted tiles from last week's workshop with Flo, we'd love to see those too. We will be back next week on Thursday, the 20th of May, with Michael O'Reilly for a lovely workshop learning how to paint beautiful textural clouds. We'd love to see you all for that, so please do register on our website. From me and everyone at Hospital Rooms, thank you all so much for joining us today. A huge thank you once again to Liz for leading today's exceptional workshop. We'll see you all again at 2 p.m. next week, Thursday. Bye, everyone.